Welcome back to Sunday Morning Quickies, episode 46 for the 12th of June, 2022. This is probably going to be the quickest Sunday Morning Quickies yet, so get your coffee. Let's get going. I just finished working on the Singer Stylist Model 457. It needed a gear change. The upper gear on the vertical shaft was dead and needed a timing belt. Easy thing to do. The upper gear, which is supposed to look like this, I do buy spares when I buy these. I keep these in stock, try to keep these in stock. Well, all that was left of it was this. And what was amusing, or not amusing, disturbing actually, was this just fell right off the shaft. I didn't even touch the set screw. Regardless, I got the new gear in, I got the timing belt in, I adjusted the timing, everything was great. And I went to do some test stitching. I brought up the presser foot and the upper thread tension wasn't releasing. It's working now because there's a temporary part in there. This is the part that was broken. You can see where the pin hits in the middle on that little crossbar. It's all smashed up. Not an uncommon problem for a 50 plus year old part that has suffered the ravages of time. So my recommendation, if you're going to do one of these, go ahead and order one or two of these. Keep these in stock if you're going to be working on these kind of machines, because these do break. I have seen so many broken pieces, for especially in this model, over the past year. I've got a dead part from another one that happens to have a good crossbar. It's the wrong color. I ordered some new pieces from Central Michigan. They should be here in a couple of days. Karla wrote that she was having problems getting the transfer fork in the correct position versus the sliding block in her 66. Well, Karla, I'm here to help. I've taken the needle bar out of this machine just so I could, and I moved the linkages up and out of the way to make it a little bit easier to see what's going on. If your sliding block is the older style that has the slit in it, do what I've done here. Remove the screw that's in the slit. Just get it out of the way. What that screw does is it spreads these two sides of the of this tab farther apart to adjust the fit inside the slot here. For our purposes at the moment, with the screw out, it's going to make everything a little bit easier. Now, what you're going to do, it said, is this surface here of the transfer fork is going to be riding up against this side. So, to get that back in, first of all, make sure that your transfer fork is in correctly. And by correctly, I mean that there is a shoulder on the screw. Make sure it is not binding. You see how this is springing back on its lonesome? Yours should do the same. Now, when you're gonna, I'm gonna put this back into the slot. I'm going to hold it so it's at about this angle. Okay, my hand is going to get in the way while I'm doing it, and I'm going to put just the top tip here in the top of the slot, just to get it started. And I might have to, actually I'm going to have to, get a finger over and move the transfer bar. There, I've got it started. Here, I'll hold it here. You can see the angle that I've got it started at. Now, take the transfer bar, move it over with your other hand, and then you can bring that in and slide it down. Now it is definitely in the correct orientation. The rest of this is just reassembly. Go ahead, put your bars in, get your needle bar back in if you've taken it out, like I did. But it's really, really not that difficult. If you're having any other problems, send me an email and I'll get you a phone number and I can talk you through it on the phone. This is a foot controller for a Willcox and Gibbs chain stitch machine that belongs to customer and friend Robin. Robin lives up on Staten Island. a while back, she had seen the video that I had done on resurrecting the turtle style Westinghouse motor that was used on a particular vibrating Michelin machine. It was a free. And she contacted me and asked me if I would take on the motor from her Willcox and Gibbs, which it had some pretty bad problems. Well, I was a little hesitant. I'd never worked on one of those before. And honestly, I'd only seen one or two prior to that, but never worked on one. But under the theory that God hates a coward, I was like, well, okay, you really got nothing to lose because it's not working now. I can't make it any worse. So I took it on. I neglected to shoot video, which I really wish I had because it was an interesting motor rebuild. But regardless, I got that motor working beautifully. She subsequently sent me the foot controller, which was a different model than this, and I redid that, and now it's working perfectly. This past weekend, Robin and I got together, and it's always nice to meet customers face-to-face when you don't normally do so, and I did a little bit more work on her other Willcox and Gibbs, but she had this controller, which is not working properly. And I took it apart. I saw something that was extremely messed up, my opinion anyway. And I'm like, look, I'd really like to take this back to the shop, put it on the bench, tear into it, maybe shoot some video while I'm doing it, and see if I can fix this and make it work right. So, without further ado, let's take this puppy apart. Let's get some of the dirt out of here first. There's an inordinate amount of crud in this machine. So let's get this apart, shall we? Okay. Let's see what we got here. Nothing else is holding that in place except this spring. So, we use a pair of needle nose pliers. Spring is disconnected. Man, is there a lot of dirt coming off of this. Okay, and I have to pull this cotter pin off to get this apart. And these will lift out. And there's a lot of corrosion on these. Oh, yeah. One of the complaints that the owner of the machines, Robin, one of her complaints was this controller was either all or nothing. You know, you got nothing unless you floored it. And, I am far from being an expert on this style controller, but I do know that they're not supposed to be an all or nothing proposition. So let's get that off of there. We'll reconnect that in a moment. And get that on. I'm going to solder that resistive load back on there. Actually, let me get a meter and check that. I want to see what this resistance looks like from one end to the other. Okay, that's 74.7 ohms. This one, well, there's part of your problem, lady. There's no resistance on that, so that coil's got a problem. So let's first resolve this one and get some solder holding that wire on here. Then we'll take the other wire out and we'll try to fix it. Okay, let's measure that again. Come on. Okay, 73 ohms. Let's get this other one out. See if we can figure out what the problem is with this side. Now, I'm going to do this a little differently on this one. Just snip that there. And I'm going to bring this tab up to make a surface that I can solder onto. Let's take a measurement. This one is an open circuit. Nothing. Completely open. All right. Let's see if we can find where the break is. All right, we have a significant amount of corrosion here. This is a wire wound resistor, as is this. This is a wire wound resistor. The insulated coatings is removed from one side of each of them. There's a terminal here, there's a terminal here. That's all we're going to be concerned about with that. Now, we look at this. Let me get a meter in here in shot, and I'll show you something with this. All right, observe. That's full continuity there. Well, as much as this cheap meter is going to be. Now, if we have a wire attached to the terminal, it would be here. Back here, we're seeing 71 ohms. And as we move farther down the resistor, that resistance changes. Come on, losing conduction. There. All right, so as we go closer towards the other side, we get to the other side, we're down to just a couple of ohms. Okay, now we have two of those that are mounted side by side in the box. This is above that. And what happens is this piece of copper, which this was covered in corrosion, which was part of this thing's problem. This rests thusly, making contact. And as we, you'll see, this is curved. You see the curve in the copper. As you press your foot down, it goes closer and closer and closer until you're at full throttle when this is all the way down, and this piece of copper is just going across the two terminals, getting out of the path of the resistors completely. And that is what gives us the variable resistance for the speed control on this. It's rather ingenious. This one's problem was this is absolutely filthy. And I actually have to do a little bit more cleaning and polishing on this yet. There's still a lot of crud on this. That was part of its problem. This variable resistor was broken. I fixed it. This one was kind of broken. Much easier fix. But that's all that this portion's problem had. Now, the complaint when I picked this foot controller up from the customer was that it had one speed, full speed. It didn't do anything. Robin was telling me it would not do anything unless you had your foot all the way to the floor. Well, sewing machines are not top fuel dragsters, so once we plug it into the wall, be able to plug a motor in, we should get full speed control. So, I've got a little bit more cleaning to do to get the crud off of this copper here. And once I get this crud off, we're back in business. We have this curved piece of brass in here, or copper, I should say. And you can see how we have the exposed portions of the wire wound resistors. So as the pedal gets depressed, this curved piece starts making contact farther and farther and farther down the resistor. Of course, as it's going through, it's shorting out everything back here. So the resistance value is whatever is, say, like if it's making contact at this point here, going across, everything back here is shorted out, and it's whatever resistance value remains in that first set of the resistor on both sides, that's how much resistance it is. So it's going to be in, as you go farther, it's less and less resistance. Now, when you get to the very end, these two contacts here contact, when it's all the way down, contacts these rings where the wires are connected to, shorting it out completely, and you get full speed. So that's how this thing, this particular unit works. It's pretty damn cool. Okay, we've got Robin's foot controller back together again. And let's plug a motor into it and try it out. I have here a 0.8 ampere sewing machine motor. This is a standard. And let's see a few variable speeds now. Well, she certainly does variable speed. It's the design of this internally is definitely very different than what we're used to today, especially with a modern electronic controller. But considering how old this is, it works remarkably well. Last but not least, in answer to stay or go about that 99 that I featured about a week or so ago, it's going. I've decided I'm going to sell it. It'll be up on my website sometime in the next week or so. As you're watching this, Liz and I are on vacation. When we get back, I'll get it up on my website. Link will be down. Well, link to my website's always down in the description anyway. You'll find it there under Machines for Sale. But yeah, I decided I'm going to let that one go at a decent price. So if you're interested, that's where it's going to be. Like I said, this was a fast one this week. Thank you so much for watching. We'll see you on the next one.